you joke, I'm a year older. And we didn't change the temperature, did we? Remember last year was just as hot? Must be because we're in town. But you know, when you get older, you kind of look back and you say, gee, I never had any problems with all the kids had when I was kids. And the other day I said, gee, I think I'm going to try some of those things that the other kids did. Or that the kids are doing now. So I decided I was going to get into drugs. Seriously, I said, that looks like they're having fun. So I said, I'm going to try some of that hash. Well, you know, I tried it the longest time, and I couldn't get the corned beef to burn. Tried smoking it. It doesn't burn. Then I was going to snort some coke. I damn near drowned. I shouldn't laugh at my own jokes. It's nice to be back. We have a kind of a different show. For those of you who might have been disappointed that Mike Hashem wasn't here, he will be back next year or a year after. But we have some absolutely fine banjo players from Delaware and a super gal from New York and some guys from Boston that are going to knock you dead, and I know you're going to enjoy the show. To start off the show, though, we usually bring a band in that is not top flight. And this band is not top flight. They told me this back then. But they enjoy playing, and they come from Portland, and they're called a State Street Jazz Band. And without any further ado, we'll introduce you to them. Come on, you guys.
Thank you. see all the hot spots, you meet all the big shots down on Bourbon
going to do them for you either in the first half of the show or the second half of the show. Al has credits that look like a laundry list. They go on and on and on. So I'll read a few of them to you, or at least some of them. He plays with the Delaware Symphony Orchestra. He runs his own banjo music school. He's played with Guy Lombardo. He's played with Art Mooney's Guy Lombardo Band. He's been director of the Barn Dance TV show. Played with Bob Crosley, Al Raymond. He's played with all of them. He's played all over the world. And just a lovable guy and a nice guy. Without further ado, please give a warm welcome to Al Smith from Delaware. Al?
Thank you very much. I certainly appreciate that nice interruption there. And say, he's practically done my whole act already for me. Goodness gracious. I'm going to move this around just a little bit in front of me here for me. All right. Okay, as Jerry said, my name is Al Smith. I know some of you folks might remember a famous politician by that name. He ran, he was governor of New York State, ran for president back in 1928. I did a show not long ago, and a lady came up to me, and she said, is your name Al Smith like the famous politician? I said, yes, ma'am, it is, but I'm no relation. I just happen to have the same name. She said, I saw your performance. She said, you know you ought to do like Ronald Reagan. I said, you mean get into politics? She said, no, get out of show business. So. Well, I hail from a little town down in Delaware. Now, a lot of you folks, I don't know how familiar you are with Delaware, but Delaware is the 49th largest state in the Union. And it's right between Baltimore and Philadelphia. If you're going south on I-95, it's right between Little Barrel and Resume Speed there. You make a right turn. And it's the home of the State University, where I come from. The state of Delaware has their State University of Delaware there. And in our state, we recognize that as the fountain of knowledge where youth go to drink. And let me tell you, when you live in a college town, you never know what you're going to run into. And some of these youngsters today, I'll tell you, the way they dress, I'll tell you, I have a hard time telling some of the boy students from the girl students. I'll tell you, they wear the dungarees so tight to wear them out from the inside. And they wear these real high spiked heels and these weird looking long dangling earrings and these weird looking hairdos. And the girls don't dress much better, I'll tell you. I said in the drugstore talking to druggists the other day, I said, do you see that student down at the other end of the counter? I said, I can't tell if that's a boy student or girl student. So he turned around and looked. He said, it's a girl student. I said, how in the world can you tell? He said, because I'm his mother. So I don't I was walking down Main Street in Newark the other day, and there was a young student laying out in the gutter. I looked down at him. I said, son, are you all right? He said, please, sir. He said, put your ear to the ground and listen. I said, what's happening? He said, lay down alongside him and put your ear to the ground and listen. So I lay down alongside of him. I put my ear to the ground. I listened. I said, I don't hear anything. He says, yes, it's been like that all day. So I better get moving or I'll be up here all night, I guess. I'd like to start off on the old-time American banjo with a little bit of American medley here. Being up in the North Country, I thought I might do a couple Yankee tunes here and kind of like to start off with a little musical guessing contest here. I'm going to play three tunes by George M. Cohan, and John Stewart's going to help me out here on the bass, and I'm going to play three tunes, and you see if you can guess what they are, okay? The first one's Yankee Doodle Dandy. The second one is Give My Regards to Broadway. All right there, John, you got a little bit like this. Thank you. you know, if you go back into the 20s, which was the heyday for the banjo family, like the violin family, got quite large. For instance, there's a five-string banjo, this is a four-string plectrum, and there's a tenor banjo, and an eight-string mandolin banjo, and there's a bass banjo, and a cello banjo, and so forth. And this little fella here, which I'd like to introduce to you, and this is a ukulele neck on a banjo body, and I'd like to play a little long hair music, if I may. You know, being bald is one of those things in life where you can be a loser and still come out on top. Although my wife gives me another message. She used to go to the store and bring me Head and Shoulders. Now she brings me Mop and Glow. So I don't know. I work up in the Catskills in the summer months, and last summer a couple of fellas and I were out on the lake, beautiful old lake up there, Lake Okwaga they call it, and up in New York State, and it's a beautiful lake there. We're out fishing out in the middle of the lake, about a mile and a half in diameter, and one of the fellas stood up in the boat flipped over, and we're out there flopping around in the water. Fellow over on the shore saw us, so he got in the boat, came out to get us. First fellow's head bobbed up, he grabbed him by the hair, yanked him up in the boat. Second fellow's head bobbed up, he grabbed him by the hair, yanked him up in the boat. My head bobbed up, they pushed me under. He said, go down and come up right. So I don't know. Just... I would like to do a little love song on the banjo uke here, and I'd like to dedicate it to my wife tonight, wherever she is. Actually, I've been unlucky in marriage twice. My first wife left me, and the second one didn't. It's, like the other day down my way, we had a nice summer day. We're out working in the yard. She's on one side of the yard, I'm on the other. All of a sudden, out of a clear blue sky, she walked all the way across the yard, kicked me on the ankle. I said, what was that for? She said, that's for being a lousy lover. So I thought about it a little bit, so after a while I walked across the yard where she was and I kicked her on the ankle. And she said, what was that for? I said, that's for knowing the difference. But I tell you, I really shouldn't talk about my wife. My wife is really an angel. Always up in the air harping about something. I mean, she just... Always wants to know what I'm doing. What are you doing? What are you doing? I sat down the other night to read a book. She said, what are you doing? I said, I'm reading a book. She says, what kind of book are you reading? I said, it's a mystery book. She says, what's the name of it? I said, checkbook. Just seems like... But you know, like all married couples, we have a few words now and then, you know, like all married people do. We had a few words last week. I still got mine. I never got to use them. She said, you know you didn't have to marry me. I said, yeah, but you weren't so sure at the time, were you? My wife goes with me a lot of times when we're out doing shows. You know, sometimes she drives along with me if I have a long drive to go, and she drives a little bit and I drive, you know. She's a big help that way. And of course, today, you know, it's nice coming up this area because, I tell you, show business today has changed. I mean to tell you, friends, show business is not what it used to be. My golly, I'll tell you. I got booked into Philadelphia last week for a gay 90s party, and I got there and all the men were gay and the ladies were in their 90s. I mean, it just... But I'll tell you, my wife has nerves of steel. My wife, nothing shakes my wife. She's just calm, cool, and collected all the time. I mean, she's just steady as a rock, I'm telling you. Last New Year's Eve, we went to visit some friends. We're driving back home, driving through the main street in Newark, and a police officer pulls me over. I pulled the car over, I wound the window down. I said, what's the matter, officer? He said, sir, he said, you were driving 35 miles in a 25-mile zone. I said, officer, I was watching my speedometer, I'm sure. He said, sir, he said, I clocked you for over a mile. You were doing 35 in a 25-mile zone. My wife, very calm, cool, and collected, put her finger right up in the officer's face. She said, officer, don't you dare argue with my husband when he's been drinking. I tell you, she's got nerves of steel. By golly, I did a show out in Pittsburgh last October, and we're driving down the Pennsylvania Turnpike. She's driving the car, I'm snoozing off on the passenger side a little bit, and by golly, I just happened to wake up for a split second. I look at the speedometer, we're doing 75 miles an hour. I look out the rear window, here comes a Pennsylvania State Trooper behind us. Look back at the speedometer, 85 miles an hour, two troopers behind us, 95 miles an hour, three troopers. My wife whips that car into the rest stop, she hops out of the car, runs into the little room marked ladies. 15 minutes later, there are 3 Pennsylvania state troopers patiently waiting outside the door. My wife, very calm, cool, and collected, walked out. She said, "I bet you boys thought I wouldn't make it." Well, I would like to do this little tune just for her tonight, wherever she is, and a little bit of an old classic love song called Liebestraum on the banjo ukulele, and it goes a bit like this.
As soon as I finish here tonight, I got to pack up and get on the road and
get over to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, where I'm going to be appearing on September the 2nd. So we kind of got to get this thing in a little bit tighter. I'll give you the notes and let's try it once more now. Here we go, all together now. La 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 la. Hey, beautiful, very, very good. Now remember, this is just old-time country foot stomping music, so if you want to pat your feet and clap your hands and throw money at the banjo player, while you just feel free to do so, all right? Okay there, John, let's go a little bit like this now.
Which is a mandolin tuned like a tenor banjo. Yeah, I'm in real trouble here. We better move right along. The two other gentlemen that play with Peter in this program are John McGann and Mitch Nealon, and they are the foremost practitioners of ragtime swing music, and I think you're going to enjoy them. They're the new Boston Ideals, and they're here to entertain you tonight. Boys, come on up.
Evening. Actually, we were sent here by the physical plant here, lacking air conditioning. They decided if they put somebody up in front here who actually looked hotter than you did, suddenly it would cool you off. So here we are in our asbestos-lined suits. You'll have to excuse us for a minute while we get intimate with our microphones here. We're going to change the pace here a little bit, friends.
We haven't started yet,
that's true. But we're going to take you back a few years here, back to the 1880s, and we're going to give you a little bit different vantage on this banjo sickness that you're going to see here tonight. And we're going to go back to the roots of the style here, and we're going to play you two tunes to begin with, one from the 1880s, and then we're going to jump way, way into the future, into the 1903 era. And we will play first for you a tune called Mississippi Breakdowns, which is an old-time banjo music hall number, and then into a little rag number called Tattoo. So, there you go.
Thank you. Thank you.
have a little issue to discuss here. Just, you know, the three of us and all of you. Mitch is bothered because Jerry misintroduced his instrument. I know what you're thinking. Terrible to have your instrument badly introduced or misrepresented. This, friends, in fact, is not a mandola, but is the deeper-throated instrument known as the mandocello. Good, I'm glad we set that straight. If we have any science buffs out there in the crowd, has anybody read about the fact that scientists have now discovered that whales crawled on land? The little vestigial feet that they discovered stuck on the back end of the whale there? See this little peg here? This is much like this little vestigial foot of the ancient whale. This is the fifth string peg of the five-string banjo, and it will be the only one you'll see here tonight. Thank you. We're going to do one more tune for you, and then we're going to go jump into the pool. Tin foil lined suits and hot lights.
Can't
beat it. All right, here's a little tune called Shuffle Along, and then we will indeed do the same, and we will be back to share intimate moments like this again with you in the second half of the show. Dating from 1911, Shuffle Along.
Super. This next gal was in the first show that we did here, the first Banjo Spectacular. How many of you remember the first one, or were here the first one? A few, anyways. Well, Cynthia was here with Eddie Davis, and they came as the, what do you call it, the New York Banjo Ensemble, okay? And since that time, that was 6 years ago, was it, or 7 years ago, this girl's been all over the world. Her career has taken off. The minute she played here, it was on the way. But at least you know that we did a little bit in launching her career, and she's touched base with some of the very important people. Well, I say important people, but by name dropping, but they are the giants of the industry. And today, I would say that Cynthia is probably the top female banjo player in the world, and she's very well ranked in the male area as well. So she can hold her own no matter where she goes. She's played with Woody Allen, or she plays and lives in New York City and plays with Woody Allen in his jazz band down in the Village. She's played with George Siegel, who's my kind of banjo player because he's a kind of a smolchy banjo player. You know, he has more fun playing. He doesn't play that well, but he sure has a good time at it. Let's see. She's been on ABC, CBS morning shows. She's been director and consultant on the banjo and helped to instruct some of the stars in Purple Rose of Cairo, Sophia's Choice. She co-stars on the new Spike Jonze show. She's been to Germany, France. She did a tour in Japan. She does and plays everywhere and plays all over that banjo. And she's going to be, she's so exciting, she's just going to live you. Cynthia, come on out. Give her a nice warm welcome. Cynthia Sayer.
Favorite song for last month. It's called Todd, I can't believe that you're in love with me. Got him set?
Thank you.
Cynthia Sayer, and she'll be back later. We're going to have a short intermission now. And, excuse me. The tapes, by the way, Al and Cynthia both have some excellent tapes, and Al is carrying some tapes of Perry Bechtel, which is really a fabulous tape, and if you'd like to buy them, they'll be out, set up out there. Remember, there is Diet Coke or something cold downstairs, and the intermission will be, if we're on schedule, about 10 minutes off, about 20 minutes, okay? And you'll hear the piano play, and that'll mean you got about 10 minutes to get back in here, okay? Words that need to be said about hospice, and today that I'm going to ask Ed to come out here. Ed Spauer.
Thank you, Jerry. Not only thank you to Jerry, but thank you to all of you for coming tonight, supporting Strafford Hospice Care and its ongoing work year-round. Well, I say what I'd like you to do is real quick open up to the very middle of your program, where you'll find a page about knowing Strafford Hospice Care. In that, you'll find out at least headline-wise, what we do. But these things don't happen without the support of people like you, without the work of people like Jerry putting a program together like this, without people who have worked in the past to build the program, like Bill Reeve down here, who's recording. You'll see his a chance to purchase videos of this if you'd like. But the real people who keep Strafford Hospice Care going are the volunteers, the volunteer board members and the volunteers who go out and sit with patients who have very few months to live in some cases only days, and it's those people who keep it going. I would like those people, the board members and the volunteers, and there's a couple of staff people in the back, stand up, and let's give them a hand, because that's what it's about. Then if you turn the page in your program, it says how you can help. As I said, you've already helped by being here, but there's a lot of other ways that you can help, and I'd like you to seriously consider it. You can leave that page tonight on your way out. We'll pick them up, or you can mail them into our office. Either way, see me, anything. We'd love to meet you and to have you become part of Strafford Hospice Care. Thank you very much.
Now we have the second half of our show, so we cut down on the introductions and we just get back to the banjo players on a hot night like this. I know that's what you come to hear. So without any further ado, I'm going to bring back those three tuxedo guys that look so handsome when they're out here. The new Boston Ideals.
Thank you.
Thank you. You are truly too kind. We're going to zip right along here, and we will do you a tune now. I mean, after that gorgeous Russian-inspired anthem we heard earlier in the program. Not to be outshone. Your friends, the New Boston Ideals, will perform for you Egyptian Princess.
Thank you. much, folks. Enjoy the rest of the show.
You bought an idea. Real kind, huh? And now we're going to bring back that that sweet little thing, Cynthia. I call her Cynthia. I don't know if she likes that or not. Cynthia is probably more appropriate, but bring her back, and she's going to do some of her hot stuff now. Let's have a nice warm welcome for Cynthia Sayer, okay?
Start out with a tune for Al Smith. He keeps asking me to do this song. I was just minding my business. Life was a beautiful song. I didn't have a care or a worry till you had to come along. I fell in love with you first time. I looked into them their eyes. You got some little cute way of flirting with them their eyes. Well, they make me feel so happy, and they make me no style, I am bone. Come on and break me the way for you. My heart's thumping, your shirt starts with them their eyes. You better watch out if you're wise. They sparkle and they bubble. They're gonna get you in a whole lot of trouble. You're rubber walking in there, stranger looking in there.
Thank you.
guy. Thank you. Well, now we're going to go into a whole different mood, get away from jazz and go into the classics. This is Hungarian Dance No. 5 by Brahms.
Until they drown me out. I love to see. Thank you. face of the clock and wind it up. It sounds a little bit like this. Then the old spring would get good and tight, and the old clock would be raring to go. He did not believe this could be done. Paid all my expenses out there, motel and everything, and meals and airplane flight and everything, just so I'd play this for him. And I played it for him, and he watched me play it. He said, boy, he said, a guy with your talent ought to go places. Then he told me some places I could go. So here I am in Dover, New Hampshire. I don't know. Which I'm glad to be in Dover, because I hear Dover is a gateway to Badbury, so it's nice to be here. But I you have to bear with me a little bit if I make a mistake tonight. I had a little accident the other day. I was reaching for a cigarette, and a car ran over my finger. And I don't know how the doctors are up here, but I went to my doctor to get it cleaned out, and I went over to his office, and he was busy. People were coming in one door and going out the other. The receptionist was signing them in, and the nurse was going back and forth. And after a while, the doctor come out, and he said, what's the matter, Mr. Smith? I said, Doc, I got a little. He said, look, we're busy, please. He said, go in the next room, put the hospital gown on. I'll be in a minute to examine you. I said, well, Doc, it's just a. He said, look, please go in the next room, put the hospital gown on. We're busy. Go in the next room. There's a gentleman there in a hospital gown reading the newspaper. I said, boy, I said, this is some doctor. I said, I got a little cut and got to go to all this trouble. He said, buddy, I don't know what you're complaining about. He said, I came here to work on the telephone. You know, he makes me come in for an annual checkup every 3 months. Last time I went, and I said, Doc, I said, I get up in the morning, I look in the mirror, I said, my hair's falling out, I get red splotches all over my face, my jowls are sagging, I said, I look ugly. He says, yeah, but your eyesight's good. I said, well, how do I stand? He said, I don't know. He said, that's what puzzles me. He said, look, he said, I know you've been busy, you've been traveling a lot, you've been doing a lot of shows around the country in Canada. He said, I want you to slow down. He said, you are going to have to slow down. So I tried to get a job with the post office, but they were all filled up. So my wife and I decided to take a little trip down to Florida. We'd never been to Florida before, so we rented a camper. We drove down to Florida, got down there late one Thursday evening about dusk, backed the camper into the campsite. My wife said, take the bucket from the camper, go down to the creek and get some water so I can fix supper. So I got the bucket, I went down, and about the time I dipped it down in the water, this huge ugly alligator stuck his nose up. I'd never seen one. I mean, he must have been 50 feet long, great big jagged teeth. It scared me so bad, I dropped the bucket. I run back to the camper. Wife says, what's the matter? I said, there's a big alligator in that creek down there. She said, silly, that alligator's just as scared of you as you are of him. I said, honey, if that alligator's as scared of me as I am of him, that water ain't fit to drink anyway. I'll tell you. At one time here. I'm going to play the melody on one banjo and the accompaniment on the other banjo. Pat my foot to Dixie and whistle Smoke It's in Your Eyes all at the same time. All right? So a little medley here of Long, Long Ago and Skip to Maloo. Now if we get all this balanced out here, it takes two banjos and a big laugh. Something like this now. Here we go. Thank you. for you before I go. But before I go, I'll tell you, you've been a real nice audience, and I certainly appreciate the nice warm welcome you've given me and the nice warm weather you've given me. And a friend of mine in vaudeville years ago told me, he said, whenever you have a nice audience, and you have been a nice audience, he said, always close your performance by saying something warm and gracious. So in closing, I would like to say, gracious, it's really been warm up here tonight. And about a nice round of applause for John over here, helping me out here. John, thank you very much. Thank you. This banjo I have here has a little gadget on it called a soft pedal. This was invented about 1925 over here in Groton, Connecticut, and gives you a little different sound. Normally the banjo's like this. With this mute on it, kind of sweetens it up like this. And you can get a little mandolin imitation out of it like this. You know, it's the old Italian folk song, Way Marie. I did that at a show one night, and there was a gentleman sitting on the front row, and tears just started coming out his eyes. And after the show, I went over to him. I said, sir, I noticed when I played the old Italian folk song, Way Marie, I said, tears were just streaming down your cheeks. I said, you're an Italian? He said, no, I'm a musician. If you work this back and forth, you get a little wow-wow sound like this. I'd like to show you how that works on a thing called a blues medley, starting off with the old St. Louis blues and a couple of other old classics. It goes a little bit like this. We'll be right back.
Isn't he great? He'll be back in the finale in a few seconds. Great. And he's all like, here they are, the State Street. Gad Man.
Thank you.
City that jazzed you in the second half.